this today I am supposed to tell you about acute leukemia, okay? Because if you see that if you see in your MBBS exam, most of the cases are either from nephrotic syndrome or thalassemia, or you can get acute leukemia. Those are important for your undergraduate teaching and exam also. Okay. So hereby, I will give you some idea what is acute leukemia, how to approach them, and there are some slides where you can see the demonstration of clinical signs. These slides are prepared by Dr. Abdul Majid and Dr. Poonam Kamani along with me for your information. So hereby I just tell you about some of the important points about acute leukemia first, and I will take your questions, whatever question you have. Okay. When you go through this class, after the class, you should be able to know actually what is leukemia, what are the types of leukemia, how do they present, how do you identifying the clinical clues by noting signs and symptom, what will be your minimum investigation workup, and what are the recent update about investigation, what are the management principles, and how do they fare for survival, and what are the emergency you can have in your practice after you pass from this disease. So this is the learning objective. These topics, this learning objective will cover in the session. Clear? So before we start, what is leukemia? Leukemia is nothing but say neoplasia of blood cells, which actually begins in the bone marrow with abnormal blood cells. But actually, though leukemia means all the blood cells, generally we means WBC. And at the beginning, I just want to say, how do they respond? So it is quite common in children. I will see in the next slides. And for your kind information, with recent treatment and advanced treatment in a very good center, they have a very good chance of survival also, around 90% and all. And if the patients remain well, even after 10 years of remission, they will actually take them as cure. Though actual, this is called cure in leukemia or cancer survival. Before you go to the leukemia itself, actually leukemia means cancer of the immature blood cells. So what is immature blood cell, you should know first. In lymphoid series, it is lymphoblast, and it is even myeloid series, it is myeloblast. And you have to know how to identify them, because you may get in pathology slides also, even ALL, AML slides. You have to identify myeloblast and lymphoblast first, because this is required for identification in bone marrow, and these are the points already given over there. You have to remember those. You see, myeloblast are bigger cells and have some wire rods in some particular myeloid leukemia. Lymphoblast are relatively smaller cells with abnormal. If it is neoplastic, it has some abnormal cytoplasmic nuclear ratios. Now, leukemia is a huge thing, I'm telling you, because there are super specialty on oncology. You know, right now people are doing oncology super specialties. So what I'm telling is that out of all oncology or hemato-oncology, leukemia is a big chunk, you know, big number. So it's not possible for you to know all the things, but out of them, leukemia is a big quantity. At least you should know leukemia. Now, if you say leukemia, out of that, leukemia also have a different types, acute, chronic, and these things. But for your level of understanding, we want you to know only acute leukemia. Though CML, CLL are there, CLL do not occur in children, for your kind information. We don't need anything about CLL. And CML is also rare. You don't want to read also that. You have to know the acute lymphoblastic and, if possible, acute myeloid. And out of that, whenever we say leukemia, it is basically acute lymphoblastic because it is more than 80% cases. So now you can see what is required for you. You require, at least you should know acute lymphoblastic. That is enough for your understanding and for your purpose of knowing the disease. Second. Now, so I will tell you mostly about acute lymphoblastic leukemia. You see, I have told you that it is a most common childhood malignancy. And you see, even you can differentiate acute lymphoblastic in different cell line. It may be B cell line, T cell line. So out of that, B cell is more, T cell is less. You see, incidence, it occurs mainly in the toddler, 2 to 5 years, early childhood, this group. There are boy preponderance, and this is a important size of all childhood cancers. And people say that though ALL actual etiology don't know, even then there is some genetic basis in some of those acute leukemia. There may be radiation exposure. Many other hypotheses has been put forward, and these are more common than general population in syndromic babies like Down syndrome, Fanconi's, neurofibromatosis disease, this type of syndromic child. Now, you should know what are the manifestations of leukemia. Now, how will you identify? A patient comes to you. This is clinical signs and symptoms. If a patient comes to you, how will you identify? What are the clues? You see, this is basically neoplasia of cell lines. So you see, cell line will be involved. So if there is anemia, as the marrow will be infiltrated by abnormal WBC, so there will be less hemoglobin production, so it will be pallor. So one is pallor. Then as there is pallor, patient will feel fatigue. Patient will have, because of increased basal metabolic rate, because of neoplasia, have fever. As the bone marrow infiltrated by the abnormal WBC, so there will be difficulty in production of platelets by megakaryocyte. So you will get PTK and purpura, that is skin bleed. And as the lymphoid leukemia, lymphoid cells are also there in the lymph nodes. So there will be some abnormal lymph nodes enlargement causing lymphadenopathy. And as the marrow is not functioning well, so extramedullary erythropoiesis and reticulothelial hyperplasia will occur. So you'll get hepatosplenomegaly and splenomegaly. So if you say manifestation of leukemia, you have to look for these signs and symptoms: pallor, fatigue, fever, skin bleeds, lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly and splenomegaly. So this thing is the clues. So any patient, when you suspect leukemia, you should look for this clues and bone tenderness. Because there is marrow expansion, you can get bone tenderness or sternal tenderness. Clear? So if you see this patient, what is the most prominent thing? You see that cervical glands are so much enlarged. You can even see it from outside that it is, neck is totally distorted by enlargement of cervical gland. So you see cervical lymphadenopathy. This is visible, but sometimes you palpate and identify the cervical lymphadenopathy. Now I'll ask Dr. Poonam. He will tell you about some of the video demonstration of how to see the signs and symptoms related to leukemia. Poonam, please.
Yes, everyone got this one. is it 41? If anyone is having any problem, please unmute yourself and tell right now. So as I think so, no one is having any problem. So
ma'am, your sound is echoing, ma'am.
Tell me.
We cannot hear you clearly, ma'am.
Okay, one second. Hello?
I'm still echoing, ma'am.
Hello?
In small children, before examining a child, we should obtain assent after explaining.
Hello? Hello? Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Audible, ma'am.
How is it audible?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. We can hear the sound from the slide also.
You have heard the sound as well as you have seen the video. So, as we know, always remember, this is not only for leukemia, but for other examination also. In case of children, we take assent. It is not known as consent. Okay. So, make sure before examining any child to prevent apprehension, you should always take consent. That is what we have assent, sorry. That is what we have shown in this current video. Okay. Is it fine? I hope it is fine for everyone. Now I will hand over to, now the second one is demonstration of anemia. I hope this was also audible, but still I will play one.
For demonstration of anemia, we look for pallor at lower palpable conjunctiva, which may not be correct in case child has rubbed his eyes or cried frequently. Second place to examine pallor with dotting of the tongue, heart pad. The third one is palm of the hand, which should be examined by cupping and comparing with the examiner's own hand. Finally, we should see pallor over general skin surface.
Hello. Yeah. I hope demonstration of anemia is equally understandable by all of you. Any doubt anyone can ask at the end, you can note down and later ask at the end. Okay. The way exactly it is shown, this way exactly you should see, and make sure you should not stretch your hand while stretch the patient's hand while examination, because if in case you will stretch the hand of the patient, the fingers, the hand palm freezes, as well as your other parts of the palm becomes equal. So you won't be able to understand. In case you do cupping of the hand, the creases of the palm are very well visible, and you can differentiate the gradation of anemia, which is not very important. Simply, I am just telling that in case of some pallor, okay, some pallor, the creases are darker than the other surface of the palm. Whereas when a patient is having severe pallor, the creases become equal color to that of the rest of the palmar surface. That is why you should do cupping of the hand. Now the next one.
For For demonstration of anemia,
bleeding manifestations, I will tell her to explain further.
Enter. Now you see that bleeding manifestation. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Okay.
So you have to look for bleeding manifestation. This is very important in leukemia. Clear? And bleeding manifestation are basically you have to look for the skin bleed. Then you have to look for the major bleed. You have to look for the minor bleed. You have to look for the reveal bleed. You have to look for the conceal bleed. And there are different types of bleed. For skin bleed, skin and mucosal bleed, you should look for the petechiae and purpura. Petechiae are less than 1 or 2 millimeter, small. Purpura around 1 to 2 millimeter skin bleed. These are not blanchable. Clear? Then you have to look for the mucosal bleed. Suppose hematemesis, melena, hematuria. These are all mucosal bleed. Then you have to look for conceal bleed. Sometimes the patient had CNS bleed. So you will not able to see the bleed. But patient will have headache, seizure, hardened pallor. So this is conceal bleed. Suppose the patient had an intra-abdominal bleed. That is conceal bleed. You cannot see it. But you have to understand the patient is having severe abdominal pain, pallor. So means conceal bleed somewhere in the abdomen. So this is the way you have to look for conceal bleed also. And you have to try to understand the amount of bleed. Suppose the patient had too much of bleeding, so major bleed, so you require immediate blood transfusion. If it is a minor bleed, then you may not require blood transfusion immediately, but it will give you some time. So bleeding manifestations has to be assessed in all leukemia type of patients very carefully, because it is not only the manifestation, it will also help you assessing the emergency in management. Suppose the patient had a joint bleed, that is called hematrosis. So any patient who had leukemia or oncology related illness, they can have bone marrow depression, bone marrow infiltration. So they can cause platelet quantitative defect. So that can cause different types of bleed. So any patient will use, and that may be emergency. So whenever you get a patient with this type of patient, you should look for petechiae, purpura, ecchymosis, hematrosis, hematuria, hematemesis, melena, reveal bleed, conceal bleed, major bleed, minor bleed. You have to understand this very well, I'm telling you, because it will also, it's required for your management, very important. Clear? Not only diagnosis, but immediate management also depends upon how much patient has bleed.
Vital lymph nodes should be palpated properly for all the routes. The submental, submandibular, preauricular, postauricular, and suboccipital glands belong to the horizontal group of cervical glands. The vertical group of glands are felt along the anterior and posterior margin of sternocleidomastoid muscle, and most of them belong to the superficial group of cervical lymph nodes. Deep cervical lymph nodes are hard to palpate unless considerably enlarged, as they are deep in the anterior border or sternomastoid. Supraclavicular lymph nodes are palpated along supraclavicular fossa. Conventionally, lymph nodes should be palpated from behind in adults, but in case of small children, it can be palpated from front to prevent apprehension. Axillary following points are to be noted by palpation of the lymph node. The first one is stand on the right side of the patient.
Hello. Yeah. You have understood cervical lymph nodes, and before palpation of any lymph node, you should note the following points. What are the things there should be in your mind before starting palpation of your lymph nodes? Okay, so what are the significant lymph nodes? When will you say? Many times you will find multiple lymph nodes. Even if you are palpating your own lymph nodes, you will feel that few lymph nodes are palpable. So is it significant or not? That is important. So for knowing significance, if you are feeling that cervical lymph node or any axillary lymph node is more than 1 centimeter in diameter in any along any diameter, then it is significant. While in case of inguinal area, more than 155 centimeter, if it is there, then only the lymph node is significant. Suppose if the lymph nodes are smaller in size but there are multiple matted lymph nodes, then also it is significant. For example, in case of tuberculosis, then comes your tenderness. If any lymph node is enlarged, maybe size is smaller, but even though size is smaller, if it is tender, then also it might be significant, noting some local area infection. Or there might be some sinus which is draining through the lymph node. On the skin, you can see some sinus, something is coming out. Then also the lymph node enlargement might be significant. Okay, and otherwise, if you are getting multiple lymph nodes throughout the body, or which is also known as generalized lymphadenopathy, that is any two consecutive or non-consecutive lymph nodes are enlarged, then lymph node groups are enlarged, then also it is significant lymph node. Okay, and I have told you about this thing, and now comes your cervical lymph node,
axillary,
then followed by axillary lymph node partition.
Anterior axillary lymph nodes along anterior axillary port. Apical and central lymph nodes along the chest wall. Lateral group of lymph nodes along the shaft of the uterus. Posterior group of lymph nodes are to be palpated from behind along the posterior axillary.
And
following points.
And other lymph nodes I have written here, those are inguinal lymph nodes, epitrochlear lymph nodes, popliteal lymph nodes, abdominal and mediastinum. These are also supposed to be palpated when you are examining, but because of restraint, we have just mentioned it. You can go through the books. If any doubt, we can demonstrate you this lymph node separately for and in further slides. Now we'll go further regarding palpation of lymph nodes.
Noted by palpation of the lymph nodes. The first one is stand on the right side of the patient and be as close to the level of the patient as possible. Second, bowel and bladder should be empty. The third one is exposure of the examining area. Now, start palpation from the right lower body with the right hand below and parallel to the right subcostal margin. Another important thing not demonstrated here is liver span, which is measured by noting the upper border of liver by percussion along the right midclavicular line and noting the point where liver dullness starts. Then measuring the distance between this point and the lower border of liver, which gives us the liver span.
Okay. So apart from these things, you should remember. So apart from these things, you should remember what are the points. So liver size, how you have to measure along the midclavicular line. Suppose the lower border you have got along when you are palpating. So measure along midclavicular line from the right costal margin. Suppose you are supposed to say, for example, the liver is enlarged 4 centimeter below right subcostal margin along the supraclavicular line. In this way, you can tell the exact measurement. Span, I have told you already in the audio, then followed by shape. Shape, suppose if you are getting some irregularity along the border or something specific, you will say. Consistency, for example, it might be firm, it might be soft, it might be hard. So you have to tell accordingly, which has been mentioned to you in medicine also multiple times, I hope. Then consistency, done, border, then it is... border is what, round border or it is sharp border, that you have to mention. Surface you have to mention. For example, the surface is even or uneven. Suppose some nodules might be felt in case of some liver malignancy. When you are touching the liver surface, you are feeling multiple nodules. It is not regular as you are feeling. So that tenderness is there or not. Tenderness, while palpation, you will see the child's face. Whether child is making any face or grimacing. In this way, you will understand. Pulsation of the, any pulsation you are feeling while palpating or not, you will see that. Then hepatojugular reflex, which is generally not examined in case of smaller children, but in bigger children we do examine and for hepatojugular reflex. Now comes the palpation of spleen.
Following points are to be remembered. The first one is spleen becomes palpable when it is enlarged to 2 to 3 times of its normal size. Second, stand on the right side of the patient. Third, proper exposure of the abdomen. Fourth, bowel bladder should be empty. Now, start palpation with the right hand from the right iliac fossa with the fingers pointing towards the spleen. While put your left hand encircling the left lower rib and push the spleen forward. While palpation, note the points mentioned in the slide.
So, as it is written already, in the way you palpated the liver, similarly the same similar points are to be noted while you palpate spleen. For example, size, the same way you will say the size spleen is enlarged this many centimeters from the left left costal margin. So you will measure along the longest axis. You will take a scale and measure along the longest axis. Then comes your consistency, similar ways, whether it is soft, firm or hard. The surface, splenic notch, which is very important in case of liver spleen palpation because it helps many times to differentiate spleen from the kidney. Okay, because many times you might get confused whether it is liver or spleen. In case you are feeling some proper notch and the thing which organ which you are feeling is moving with respiration and it is not ballotable, then these are the points in favor of spleen. Okay, tenderness, you will see whether spleen is tender the same way by looking at the child's face and movement with respiration, as I already mentioned.
Tenderness,
now comes your bone tenderness.
Can be observed on sternal area, end of long bones by giving a gentle pressure and noticing pain or greenage on the child's face. Bone tenderness is caused by expansion of marrow, which causes capsular stretching leading to bone pain.
So in case of leukemia, it is very important to for any malignancy you should examine bone tenderness, because once there is any infiltration happens in bone, then as I already mentioned in the audio, there is stretching, supracapsular bone capsule gets stretched and there is pain. A pain sensation. So you have to examine the way it is demonstrated in the video, but make sure not to press very hard to further cause pain and cause confusion. Now I will hand over to sir for further.
Okay, already probably we have passed around. Actually, have started 10 minutes late. So already 30 minutes is probably over. Let's see how much we can cover. If it is not possible, then we'll cover in next. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Okay. So now this is the demonstration part already demonstrated by Dr. Pranam. Now, how do you classify ALL? This is some theory about ALL, acute lymphoblastic leukemia. There are different types of classifications available, like FAB classification, which is morphology classification. Then you have immunologic subtype, and that is according to the immunotyping classification. For you, you may not have to read all those things, but you at least know that as per morphology, they can be classified in 3 division, L1, L2, and L3, depending upon the morphology of the cells. Clear? And another is according to the immunological classification, immunotyping, immunophenotyping classification, according to the cell of origin. It may be pre-B, it may be B, it may be mature B, it may be T cell. So there are sub-classification of leukemia are there. You don't require to go in details because it may not be important for you. It is for the student who are on the higher education. Working on leukemia and others, but at least know there are classifications available it can be morphological or according to the immunophenotyping classification. Now, as you know that leukemia is a huge number of patients in oncology. So, people have tried to understand what are the prognosis, how that all leukemia will not fare similarly. So, this is also a big thing. You just remember that leukemia can be divided into standard risk and high risk, because depending on that, prognosis differs, management differs, survival differs. Clear? So, basically, standard risk means, as you see, at least age is 2 to 10 years, high risk is below 1 year, above 10 years. Initial count in standard risk is less than 50,000, in high risk is more than 50,000. And there are some difference in phenotyping and ploidy and cytogenetics also. High risk has already had some important cytogenetic abnormality. So there are some called standard risk and high risk, because that will help us to prognosticate, manage, and even survival depends on the risk stratification. This is called risk stratification. Just for your kind information. Next, what you should know that at least once you pass out, what will you do? You will be an intern. So you have to do in working in emergency. So for managing leukemia, there are experts. But in emergency, you are supposed to make the patient survive first. This is our first and duty. So you will be in emergency. So you must know how do this patient present in emergency. You must know at least oncological emergencies. At least you manage the emergency first, then there are people who will see and give expert advice and will follow other things. So at least minimum you know the common emergencies. What are the emergencies? Yes, anemia. Anemia itself is an emergency. That's why I've told you that major bleed has to be understood. Clear? Because if the patient is anemia, severe anemic, so you forget about the leukemia management. Give blood transfusion first. So that has to be noted. Second thing is thrombocytopenia, bleeding, that I told you also, that not only for diagnosis of leukemia, you require bleeding manifestation to be noted, but for management also. Suppose the patient is having thrombocytopenia and bleeding, you have to make the patient survive first. So you have to give platelet transfusion. That has to be understood. This is emergency. So this is not only manifestation, but this is also emergency. What else? Another important, very important term in leukemia, that is febrile neutropenia. Many of the patients may not die due to leukemia or relapse, but die from febrile neutropenia. This is very important. What is it? It is nothing but actually patients should have a high-grade fever documented and and neutrophil count less than 500 or 1,000 as per some books. So there is neutropenia and fever, that is febrile neutropenia. And that is very important cause of death in patient with leukemia during induction period. Because once the patient have a neutropenia, there are chance of infection, sepsis, infection, distance. These are the organism you see that you can reduce yourself. So this has to be managed very seriously, because the neutropenic child, if develop infection, require aggressive management. So this is very important thing. If you want to read, you can read in details. But this thing, at least you should know one term called febrile neutropenia. Then one thing called tumor lysis syndrome. What is that? As you know, leukemia is a leukemic cells, immature cells. So immature cells, if you give chemotherapy, what will happen? Tumor will lyse, the cells will lyse. If cells will lyse, what will happen? That will release a lot of mediators and cause biochemical abnormality. So that itself cause physiological, that itself will change the physiological homeostasis in the body and cause difficulty for surviving. So that is called tumor lysis syndrome. This is basically metabolic abnormalities. What happens? You can have hyperuricemia, hyperkalemia, hyperphosphatemia, hypocalcemia. So any patient with leukemia, when you starting chemotherapy, you should send investigation and look for this metabolic complications, because otherwise if you do not manage well, the patient can die. So this is more important where the leukemic load or immature cell load is more. It is in lymphoblastic, acute lymphoblastic, Burkitt, because here any leukemia can happen, it can happen, but where the leukemic mode is more, their chance is more. And you see the tumor size and extent is also important, that you can read yourself. Second thing, how to manage. It's also not important for you to read everything, but what we do, we give hydration, alkalination of urine, we give hypouricemic agent with allopurinol, we give furosemide, and we monitor the patient. This is in nutshell, though it's not so simple, but in nutshell, you just understand this. Second thing is superior vena cava sign. That also can cause the patient die. What is it? Because of mediastinal mass, because of lymphadenopathy, there is compression of the vena cava. So what will happen? There will be obstruction of the vena cava. There will be congestion of the face and head. And you can have respiratory distress also. This is associated with leukemia, mainly T-cell lymphoma, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, etc. That is also emergency. You see this child, if you see closely, the child neck area is slightly swollen, and there are some prominent veins which is not actually seen in this type of child. And if you see the x-ray, you see there are mediastinum is enlarged. That is basically superior mediastinal syndrome. That is basically sometimes if it causes vena cava obstruction, that causes and can cause tracheal compression also, and can cause respiratory distress. If you see this type of patient and this type of x-ray, you have to be careful about emergency, that this patient can have distress anytime. And how do you manage? Basically, we have to do propped up and lateral position, then give oxygen, and sometimes we have to give pulse steroid therapy, dexamethasone, pulse methylprednisolone, etc., to reduce the mediastinal mass. And this is life-saving. This is life-saving. You have to make the patient survive first. This is very, very important. Then and then you can say and progress for another workup and management. So this is another is hyperleukocytosis. What is it? As I saw, it is the neoplasia of WBC. Sometimes the WBC count may go very high, more than lakh. And that is called stagnation of the blood flow. And that will cause symptoms, dyspnea, headache, stroke. This is called hyperleukocytosis. You just know the term. You may not have to read all those things in detail. Then you can have a spinal compression. They can have acute diplopitis. So you read it yourself. If you have any question, you can ask us also. So how will you investigate? Investigation, as I told you, that it is basically leukemia means something difficulty, something abnormal to it, blood cells. So you have to go for peripheral blood film, complete blood count. You have to go for TLS workup, that is tumor lysis syndrome. So serum sodium, potassium, LDH, uric acid, calcium, phosphate, urea, creatinine. You have to get a baseline ECG and echocardiography because you will give some cardiotoxic drug later. You have to get an X-ray and CT chest to see there is SBC syndrome or not. You have to always do a bone marrow aspiration or biopsy to know what are the types of leukemia you are dealing, T cell, B cell, L1, L2, L3, etc., and diagnosis. And for prognostic marker and standard risk stratification, you require immunophenotyping. For that, you have to go CD marker of the leukemic cells from the bone marrow. Clear? So these are the and those patients who have some genetic abnormality associated, they have poor prognosis. So in most of the advanced center, they do genetic studies also. So this is a battery of tests you have to do in leukemia patients. Now in short, what are the treatment protocol available? You don't have to remember all those things. Just you should know that treatment of leukemia is not like sepsis. You give antibiotic and over. It is not like that. It is slightly complicated and prolonged treatment. And there are protocol available. Some center use BFM protocol, some center use UKLL protocol. Different protocols are there for management of leukemia. It is a long-term treatment. And this treatment has some phase, some stratification called induction, then called restratification, then called consolidation, then called interim maintenance, then called. So these are the way there are phases of treatment. So this is a prolonged treatment, I'm told you. It is not as simple as like treatment of your sepsis or UTI, not like that. But you don't have to know all those things. You just know that in treatment of ALL, we require some protocols, and that have some induction, consolidation type of phase, which has to be undergone by that patient. Delayed intensification. So there are different terms. It is not for me, it's difficult for me to make you understand in half an hour class. And I don't think it is required for you also at this stage of understanding. Then maintenance, etc. So ultimately, this maintenance will go on for 2 to 3 years even. So see, if you start a treatment, you'll go for 2 to 3 years. It's not like you just see for 7 days, 10 days, or 1 month. If not like TB for 6 months or 9 months, it is years, 2 to 3 years. So before starting treatment, you have to be very careful. What is the dose stratification? What is the type of leukemia? How do they fare at prognosis? What are the survival chances? How much cost is involved? So, and you have to counsel the patient properly. So it's very important selecting patients and managing the patients. So you require basically dedicated personnel for that. So just for your overview, I'm telling. So drugs used, you just read it through that what are the drugs, main drugs used. Though you don't have to require any, understand the dose and other thing. These are the drugs used. If you want to read, you can read. This is given. So these are the protocol. This is the drug used. It's quite difficult for you at this stage. You can, if you want, you can read just. Maintenance chemotherapy is there. So I'm not reading all those things. So I am showing you one patient. This is a typical genuine patient from leukemia, which we have make the patient survive. Actually, this patient was managed by me when I was in SSKM hospital. I was running in pediatric oncology clinic. And for your kind information, just want to share that I have a book on pediatric oncology also. It is available in Amazon also. Okay, so this patient was under my care at that time. This patient, you see, this was sleeping, having ALL, requiring chemotherapy. And there is chemotherapy-induced pallor, some alopecia, you see. Then serotum, some extravasation of drug causing ulcer in the your wrist, back of the wrist you are seeing. Patient is fragile, not looking. He's on chemotherapy, not fragile patients. And this patient is better. She has already completed 2 years of maintenance. She's doing well. So I've told you also that though it is a prolonged treatment, but leukemia patient have a good prognosis if you give proper therapy and follow up. So some of them, many of the patients will survive, and you will see that patient are doing well here. This is just one photograph to show you that how do they fare. So this is in nutshell, because for you as hemato-oncology and oncology and pediatric oncology and leukemia is a big thing. People are dedicated personnel, dedicated super specialty, dedicated people are working on this field. So it's not possible for you to say everything about this thing in 1 hour or half an hour. Even then, I have tried to give you an overview. And you may not require all the slide to be understood, all the slide to be memorized, everything. Just some of the term you should understand, that this is the thing, so that you can have a better understanding when you read the book. It will help you read the book. So this is this. So it's not a physical class. So actually in physical class, we can make you more, it's better for us to make you understand better, and you can interact well. And even then, this is a pandemic, so there's no other way. Even technologies are also, helping us to reach at this time of period. So even then, I have tried my best. So you may be learning treatment and management of leukemia from our slide. I am also learning how to talk to you in digital platform. Clear? So you are also learning. We are also learning. Myself also learning. So this is, see what will happen in future. So this is end of my deliberation to you. If you have any question, you can ask. If you have any question, you can WhatsApp me or ask. We'll try to make give you some answer. If you any other way you can reach us, we'll definitely try to make you understand. And in this presentation, Dr. Poonam has made all those things, videos and others. And Dr. Abdul Majid is our resident. He also did all those slides and this thing. Majid, you want to say something? Eh? So, and he has helped us to reach you by connection and other things. And he also made the slides also. Though I know that some slides are quite difficult for you. I am not telling you, you mug up, you memorize everything. You just read it through. And if you if you have any problem with that, you can ask me. So if you have any question, you can tell me. If you have not understood anything, you can tell me. But few of the slides may not be in your reach, I'm telling you. Just to give you an overview, when you know some disease, you must know the overview. Actually, if I don't know what will happen later, then I don't know why should I learn at all. So that's why I've tried to give you a simplistic overview. Though I know that some of the slides may not be required for you. And actually, once you are a medical student, you will get some of your near and dear one or something, some relative may be having symptoms of leukemia and other things you will see. So then you have to say that you should have an overview of the disease so that you can say, oh, this is this at least. So it is not only learning for your exam purpose, it is learning for your career also. That I feel that's why I have tried to give an overview. If you have any question, you definitely ask. Or you can send message on chat, I will answer. Thank you. If you have any question, any of you, any question you asked, then I will try to give you some idea, whatever in little information I know.
Sir, if there is Down syndrome with ALL, then we will do all the examinations of both.
Both?
Sometimes we will do means diagnose it as Downs with ALL means we'll examine.
No.
How will you perform the examination?
Okay. What I have tried to say that in Down syndrome, there are more chance of leukemia. It does not mean that all Down syndrome will have leukemia. Clear? So if you get a patient with Down syndrome in your exam, you first examine the patient as Down syndrome only. If he has some suggestion that he had some bleeding, this, that, then you should evaluate for leukemia. Otherwise, not. There is more chance of having leukemia in Down syndrome than other babies. That does not mean that it is all Down syndrome will have leukemia. It's not like that at all. Clear? So, if you get a Down syndrome baby, you just examine as a syndromic baby. You see the features of Down syndrome. If there is some suggestion of patient is having fever, pallor, bleeding, then you examine whether this child also had leukemia or not. Okay. Otherwise, not. Clear?
Okay, sir.
Anything? Any other question? Because why we have seen leukemia? Because leukemia, nephrotic syndrome, thalassemia, this type of cases will be given in your exam. So that's why I've tried to give you, we have decided to discuss this patient. Mostly these are given in exam, these are the common cases. That's why we have tried to discuss these patients in our lecture series and your practical classes. Any question, anything, whatever you. If you have any sorts of queries, you can ask. Learning is a continuous process. It does not mean that it ends here. You can ask me later also, by mail, by WhatsApp, whatever maybe. Learning is a continuous thing. Myself is also learning. So if you are the beginner, no problem. Okay. Okay, if there is no more question, then I'll end here, and I'll ask your CR, Mr. Sutitho, that whether we'll have to take the second session, because we have second session in next few minutes, isn't it?
Hello, sir. One question. Can we say it as hematological malignancy instead of leukemia, because we are not doing any investigation during our exams?
Okay, sure. I answered your question. In broad term, it is hematological malignancy. Clear? And hematological malignancy means many things. AML, leukemia, lymphoma, myelodysplastic syndrome, many things. But initially, it is hematological malignancy, because as we are not seeing CML, CLL, so it doesn't have any meaning to say that. We can sort it down as leukemia. I am not saying you that acute lymphoblastic or myeloblastic, that you may not say, because it is not also always possible without investigation. At least you say it is acute, it's not chronic, because chronic leukemia is uncommon in children. So you don't get chronic, so you'll get acute. So you can say acute leukemia. You may not be ready to say whether it's acute lymphoblastic or myeloblastic, that you may not, but you can say hematologic malignancy, probably, most likely acute leukemia. This much you say. Though there are some points to differentiate between acute myeloid to acute lymphoid, because myeloid series will have some gum bleeding, some other manifestation which is not common in acute lymphoid series. So, but acute lymphoid series is 80% and myeloid is 20%. So, as per statistics, acute lymphoblastic leukemia is more. But your question is very much right, that at the beginning, it will not be possible for you, whether it is a, it may be more acute lymphoblastic leukemia, but it's not always possible to say whether it's ALL or AML. So you don't comment on that. You say it is acute leukemia. Clear? Then your teacher will ask, is it AML or it is ALL? Then you answer, sir, as per statistics, 80% is acute lymphoid. So I am in favor of acute lymphoid. Clear? This is the way you... Any other question?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, Sutitho, then Guttavina, so see, in either question, if anything, you can do WhatsApp, chat, mail, I'll answer. Okay, so hereby we are ending the session.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.